Then if God forbid that I did not hear it, you can imagine the beating we would get from the capos. After that, they pushed us and 600 people into a barrack, 7 people to a bunk bed. Most of the night, 1 or 2 would fall down, and some made it and some didn't. Our job there was just standing most of the time in a cold room. When they finally sent us to work, they sent us to pick up stones from one place to the other. While being in Auschwitz, and I continuously felt the loss of my parents and my family, and Elsie continuously trying to encourage me, that someone tried to push a little piece of paper in my hand. Oh my God, when I took a look, my little sister had survived the agricultural field that she worked. She was already in Auschwitz for a few months. But how could I get to the barrack? I didn't want to leave without the barrack. I would have been punished by missing a person. And so through Elsie, she knew somebody and was able, very instrumental in my reunion with my sister. I was reunited in Auschwitz with my younger sister. How can I describe the beauty of that night? We cried, we kissed, we promised each other we're never gonna be separated again. Sure enough, after just about 2 months of being together with her, we were told that the Russian bombarded really heavily, and at the end, almost November of 44, we're gonna send out again, and this time we were sent out to Germany. They had sent all the young people to the front, and so we had to fill their positions. While we were standing in line, a German asked, he needed 10 people to work in the kitchen, and asked who spoke German. Elsie, naturally, she was a teacher, and so she knew how to speak German. When I saw she left, she raised her hand, I raised mine as well. She turned around to me and said, "Do you speak German?" And I started crying. She said, "Shut," and she said very ugly words to me because she didn't want me to cry. And she said, "How can you say you know something?" I said, "Elsie, I didn't realize what he said." She said, "Well, you better take a piece of paper and a pen and write down 10 words and memorize them, because you're gonna need to speak German." I tried to look for a piece of paper and pencil. I could not find but a piece of paper. But I was so lucky, someone had a little piece of lipstick. And with that piece of lipstick, I wrote down those 10 words. She told me if I have 100 words, I should be able to make sentences. And sure enough, we were lucky that the German did not speak to one individually, only to a group, what he wanted us to do. Working in the kitchen was like being in paradise. Learning those 100 words, I was able to communicate. You might not believe it, I learned those 100 words less than 10 days. And I speak it now fluently as well as 4 different languages. After that episode, again, people were coming to the kitchen continuously begging for some food. I tried to help, but I couldn't, because I was trying to help the hospital. Elsie and my sister, and what could I take away, a potato, a turnip, or a carrot, the most, and I would hide it in the kettles, and then when we closed the kitchen, I would take it to the hospital and give Elsie some. But I must have angered somebody. I tried to do it so nobody should see it, but maybe somebody might have seen it. And one day, as I was picking up those packages, I felt somebody behind me. Oh my God, where was my chef? "What you got there?" I said, "Food." I was so flabbergasted and scared, I didn't know what to say. He said, "Who gave it to you?" And I said, "Sir, I was going to ask you, but you had left." And he knew he didn't left. It was such a mistake of me to lie. You cannot believe it, knowing those Germans for almost 4.5 years. I must admit, he treated us halfway decently. But that night, I guess I must have angered him so very bad with my lie. He gave me such a beating. He busted my right eardrum. It turned around to a point where after the liberation, it couldn't be fixed. Only drops I can get to prevent infection, and I completely lost hearing in my right ear. After that episode, I was told again that the Russians are bombarding heavily, and this time was almost close to the end of 44, the beginning of 1945, when we again were sent to Bergen-Belsen, one of the worst camps that you can imagine. No bunk beds, no beds, straw on the floor, mice, lice, bunk bed. You have no idea. Hygienical conditions completely unknown. Water just 2 hours. If you were lucky enough to grab it, somebody knocked it out of your hand. You can't imagine. Even I myself, who have lived it, have asked myself so many times how in the world I survived. Again, one day a big tank drove into our camp, claiming the English, that our liberators, and trying to throw care packages. What a mistake that was. The people who grabbed those care packages, we found out statistically afterwards, 90% passed away due to the fact our stomachs were not able to digest that good food. And so, to that, they lost their life to dysentery, typhus, all kind of sickness. The English right away started putting lots of DDT on us, put us to showers, cleaned us up, sent us where the German had escaped a few days before, and give us new clothing. Doctors, interns, different organizations came into the camp asking us where we would like to go. Between Elsie, myself, and my sister, we were undecided. My sister at the time was 15 and a half, and so she was asked if she would like to go with the children transport to the United States. When she was asked, she was consented to go. But when her visa came in, she realized that Elsie nor I cannot go with her. I was already 17 years old, and Elsie was in her 40s. We could not go with her, and so she declined. And when her visa came in, she didn't go. We kept continuously at the eye, especially bugging my sister. You could have gone and maybe had helped us, but to no avail. After a period of a few months being in Bergen-Belsen, right by Mauthausen, we found out our oldest brother had survived Mauthausen. President Truman was president at the time. President Eisenhower was a 5-star general. He got orders from President Truman to make room for the displaced persons. And so, he got the place where they took was Stuttgart. He found word by mouth that we had survived, but how to get hers was the difficult part because all trains were pretty much beaten up. Gas was hard to come by, and so on foot and some rides that he got, he finally came to Bergen-Belsen. When he came, I jumped on him and kissed him and hugged him, and my first words to him said, Billy could have gone to the United States, but she declined. He said, is that the greeting you've given me? And I started crying. I said, I'm sorry, but it bothered me. She said, don't worry, we'll all go back to Stuttgart, and she should be able to go with a different organization. Sure enough, we all walked back to Stuttgart in 1946. My sister left for the United States with the children transport of New York. I myself and Elsie and my brother, we registered with the American consulate. When our visas came in, we had to go through a medical examination. When we find out I weighed 87 pounds and was quite ill, they put me in a hospital. My brother had tuberculosis and they would never allow him to go to the United States. After about a period of almost 2 years, my brother was still not completely healed. But some scouts from the Haganah told him, why don't you go to Israel? We'll smuggle you out. And when my brother told us, he said, well, we all go. But he left me a letter behind that he took off. And he never ended up in Israel because that Israel had no country at the time. He ended up on Cyprus in an Italian colony. I myself and Elsie, we were registered again with the American consulate. And when our visas came in through a different organization, we were gonna go. My destination actually was supposed to be Seattle, Washington. And they were gonna send me to school and then teach me a trade. But when we arrived at the pier in New York, my sister was at the pier, taking all responsibility. She said, I've been such a long time without you, I don't want you to go anywhere. And so we stayed down in New York. After a period of a few months, we found out Elsie had cancer and I lost her. I hope what happened to me never happens again.